Hey Vsauce, I'm Jake, and if I wanted to get from here to there, I would obviously run, point a rocket launcher at my feet, jump in the air, fire a missile below me, and use the explosion to propel myself into the sky. Or that's what Team Fortress 2, Halo, Quake 3, and many other video games have led me to believe. Or who could forget Freddie Wong's awesome video of a rocket jump in real life? Only thing is, how possible would a rocket jump really be without special effects or, more importantly, dying? Well, let's take the most common carryable rocket launcher, the RPG-7, with over 9 million produced, and its most recognizable warhead, the PG-7VL. Now, the deadly blast radius for this is 4 meters, with lethal fragments from the warhead flying as far as 150 meters from the impact. An average person can do a high jump around 1.68 meters, and the world record for the highest jump is 2.45 meters, which means you'd still be in the deadly blast radius. But what would actually happen to your body if a rocket exploded that close to you? First, there would be a blast wave of highly compressed air particles that fly at you faster than the speed of sound. Because of the drastic change in pressure, your eardrums would most likely pop forever. Immediately following is the shock wave, which passes through your whole body, rupturing organs and tissue. Mixed in with these waves of energy is all the debris from the rocket itself and whatever the rocket was aimed at. So let's say you have strong enough armor to protect you from a warhead that can penetrate 400 millimeters of steel. Okay, so could the RPG-7's rocket's explosion actually lift you? Not enough to make it worth your while, and definitely not enough to replicate what you see in video games. Since the launcher is recoilless, blowback from the rocket would actually push you down into the explosion. However, a big problem that you'll run into is that the warhead isn't live right after launch. It needs about 5 meters of inertia for it to be fully armed. So if you were to point an RPG-7 at the ground and fire, the rocket would shoot out and nothing would happen. But even if you had magical armor and a powerful enough weapon to technically launch you into the perfect rocket jump, acceleration would be a problem. XKCD has a brilliant what-if post about the possibility of using a bunch of constantly firing machine guns as a jetpack. It's worth reading, but points out that constant thrust is incredibly important. A single shot fired down, if strong enough to propel you like you see in video games, would induce a lethal G-force. Instead, you want something with a slow and steady burn, kind of like a jetpack, but explosions are a lot cooler, so we just need more of them. Enter Project Orion. Project Orion was a concept spacecraft that used thousands of nuclear bombs detonated gradually behind the craft to push it forward, also known as nuclear pulse propulsion. At its maximum speed, it could theoretically go 10,000 kilometers a second, which is around 3% the speed of light. To put that into perspective, it takes about 47 hours to fly all the way around the world. If Orion was flying at its peak the whole way, it would take 4 seconds. Of course, it takes time to achieve that level of acceleration and time to slow down, so if you were to go to, say, Saturn, it would take more like 2.5 years, which isn't that bad considering it's 1.2 billion kilometers away. George Dyson has an amazing TED Talk about Orion, and you can find the link in the description to watch it, but now that you're at Saturn, why not try another classic video game move, the double jump? Titan, the largest of Saturn's 62 moons, has an incredibly dense atmosphere and lower gravity than Earth, so, hypothetically, you could jump and while in the air, jump again using the thick atmosphere to launch yourself, thus successfully pulling off a double jump and reaching that elusive weapon upgrade or a giant gold coin. And if you're going to be there, you should probably wear a spacesuit.
That's right, Jake. But even here on Earth, we often have to wear suits or clothing to keep ourselves safe from the elements. Sure, humans don't have fur to protect themselves, but no other animals wear clothing. Why is that? Why do only humans make and wear clothing, and why are we embarrassed to be seen naked? Well, let's go find out on Vsauce, where I tackle that very question. Jake, tell them how to get there.
Click the annotation right here or the link at the top of the description. It's gonna be fun. Let's go.
I'll see you guys over there. Bye.